guess who's back? It's the star of Alice, Linda Lavin, and she's co-hosting the next Mike Douglas show from Hollywood with Victoria Mallory and John McCook from The Young and the Restless, plus the hit music of High Energy. Join Mike tomorrow at 4 here on TV4.
New England starts digging out from one of the worst snowstorms in history. Eyewitness News reporter Jerry Liddell is at the MDC Communication Headquarters for an update on highway conditions and Army troops moving into the area. State officials tell residents to stay in their homes and keep calm.
The storm has paralyzed highways in the Bay State. There is also widespread coastal flooding. In Rhode Island, the picture is just as bleak. Bruce will have our complete weather forecast. In sports, a win for the Celtics.
Good evening. I'm Jack Williams.
And I'm Gail Harris. Stay tuned for complete details next on TV4's Eyewitness News.
It's 11 p.m. Do you know where your package is?
Excuse me, will the real quarter pounder person please raise your hand?
You're the one, you quarter pounder people.
A quarter pounder person just loves a quarter pounder, especially with an icy Coca-Cola.
Okay, Johnny, that's 102 and a quarter pounds. Where'd you pick up that?
At McDonald's.
Quarter pounder people.
We do it all for you.
WBZ-TV, Boston's original TV station.
This is an Eyewitness News special report on the storm of February 7th with Jack Williams, Gail Harris, and the Eyewitness News team.
An ugly aftermath of the storm, 8 storm-related deaths, and now looting is spreading. 34 people have been arrested in Boston. More arrests are taking place in Revere as looters smash their way into deserted businesses. The record storm, which roared through with hurricane-force winds and nearly 30 inches of snow, has brought this area to its knees. A state of emergency remains in effect throughout southern New England. There is more coastal flooding tonight, only not quite as bad as last night. The town of Hull is especially hard hit tonight, with hundreds of people being forced out of their homes. Army troops from Fort Devens are in Revere tonight to help with the extensive flooding problems there. Furthermore, President Carter has declared this entire region a federal disaster area. Army troops and heavy equipment will be flown into the area as soon as an airport is open. There are still power outages in several areas. National Guard armories remain open tonight to provide temporary shelter. There are many victims of the storm. Among them, the famous Outermost Literary House on Cape Cod, and the much-painted Motif No. 1 in Rockport. A reminder, a state of emergency means you cannot be out driving unless it is an emergency. All schools and federal offices and most businesses will remain closed tomorrow. At this moment, 150 workers are trying to clear one runway at Logan Airport so the Army troops and equipment can land. Just moments ago, I talked with Ron Brinn of the Massport.
We have troops, as well as equipment, wanting to land at Logan Airport to help us with the job of cleaning up from this storm. Ron, how long until Logan will be open?
If our own troops here at Logan and our own equipment are valid estimates of it, it looks like about a noon arrival tomorrow of the first aircraft of this military airlift.
Has the drifting stopped?
Yes, the storm has subsided considerably, and this has given us a real jump on the plowing operation, which is involving about 50 pieces of equipment, probably 150 men. It's an amazing scene out here. Plows everywhere.
You only got to do one runway, right?
We need one runway. We anticipate giving them the full 10,000 feet, although 6,500 would be adequate for the type of aircraft they're flying.
So noon tomorrow.
Noon tomorrow, Jack.
Thank you, Ron.
And Ron mentioned they have 3 million cubic feet of snow to move by noon tomorrow. The MDC has been working around the clock trying to clear the roads and run emergency services. Eyewitness News reporter Jerry Liddell is at the MDC Communications Center and has an update on highway conditions and other information. Jerry?
The MDC Storm Center, it's a question of movement tonight. Those people who have to be moved, those people who are moving in to help them, those people who can't move, and those people, most of us, who shouldn't move at all tonight. We're talking about the flooding in Revere, Winthrop, Quincy. They are trying to move those people out of there tonight, and that is a very big effort. As for the troops that should be moving, those soldiers from Fort Bragg, as you mentioned, will be landing sometime tomorrow at Logan or at Otis, whichever airport they can clear first, and that will be as soon as possible. Earlier tonight, I asked Governor Dukakis what would be the first thing those troops will be doing.
It looks to me now, although we're going to review this during the course of the next several hours, as if the first priority for the new equipment and the personnel coming up from Fort Bragg will be 128 with the Department of Public Works. That's our most serious road problem at the present time. The Department of Public Works needs help and needs it very badly. So I think, unless there is some change between now and tomorrow morning, that when that personnel and that equipment arrives at Logan, we'll be heading for 128 with them.
As for the troops from Fort Devens, they are on their way to help with rescue efforts and digging out in the Revere area. We asked earlier where they were and told they were somewhere between Devens and Revere. We have just found out that they are in fact stalled on Route 2 at 128, Highway 128, Route 2, stalled behind a 4-ton flatbed truck. And they're trying to clear that truck out of the way so those troops can get on down to Revere and get the business done there. Governor Dukakis has just come back in here today, and in right now the MDC Center. Governor, you've been outside, and you seem more concerned than a couple of hours ago.
Well, I'm concerned, Jerry, because it's obvious that even in downtown Boston, while a great deal of work has been done, there's an enormous amount of snow. The streets are barely passable, even in the downtown core, and I shudder to think what it's like outside of that core, and we've just got an awful lot of work to do. I'd like to say two very specific things to all of the people. First, that if they see blue skies and sun tomorrow, that is not a sign that everything is well. I wish and insist that they stay in their homes. The fact that the weather is good doesn't mean that we don't have a horrendous problem out there. So I would hope that when you wake up tomorrow, if the weather looks good, that you will remain in your homes, not move around, and stay close to home and in and around your houses so that we can get this job done. I also just talked to John Carroll, the Commissioner of Public Works, Jerry, and he is particularly concerned about 128. We have some 2,500 to 3,000 cars which are stalled and stranded on 128. If you own one of those cars, the commissioner urges you not to go out there to try to find it, move it, shovel it out. It may take us as much as 3 or 4 days to open up that road. We're going to try to string out those cars one at a time and begin to clear that road, but it has to be done and done right. It can't be done because people go out there and try to move their cars. And needless to say, in the course of this operation, nobody ought to try to use 128 because it would simply be disastrous and it will further complicate what is already a very complicated situation.
Thank you, Governor. This is Jerry Liddell live at the MDC Storm Center in Boston.
Jerry and Governor, thank you very much. 3 to 4 days until 128 is ready. The Department of Public Works in Boston is already making a little dent in the snowdrifts as the storm subsides, but DPW Commissioner Joseph Cazaza is urging everybody to be patient. It will be several days before the city can clean up residential streets or even get to a lot of the residential streets. Meanwhile, the public is urged to help out by shoveling out fire hydrants and storm drains. No doubt about it, we will long remember this big storm. Bruce, is it over?
Well, yes, it is over, and I think that we're going to see some fine weather for the next couple of days to dig our way out and bring the aircraft in tomorrow. That will well above minimums for the aircraft landings tomorrow. And that, of course, is good news. The only problem being the blowing and drifting snow. Do you want any more snow? We've had 68.5 inches so far this season. That is the most snowfall for a winter season in 30 years, and we've got a ways to go to the all-time record of 90-some inches. Okay, we take a look at our national map and our local maps, and we note that the high tide is right now, and there's a northerly wind running right down Mass Bay between Provincetown, the Race Point Coast Guard Station in Scituate, so that would be fairly representative of the winds coming right down the coast. So north-facing coastal sections will take a pretty good wind blast along with this high tide that's coming up at this time. Of course, that includes the area of Hull and down the Cape areas and also north of Cape Ann. So that's the problem now. And remember the blizzard of 1888? Big snow. We only had 9 inches of slush here in Boston. You can tell your kids, I remember the great snowstorm of 1978. 27 inches, an all-time record amount of snowfall for one storm. A 24-hour record of 23.6 inches. And 29-inch snow depth right now in Boston is the greatest snow depth we've ever had on the ground in the city at one time. More weather later, it's good news.
Okay. Thank you, Bruce. Evacuation efforts are continuing along the Massachusetts coast to rescue people from the raging sea. Hundreds of residents of Revere have been evacuated from beachfront homes. The scene was ominous during high tide in the Beachmont section of Revere this morning. The seas roared over breakwaters, inundating hundreds of homes. Police officers, firefighters, and volunteers fought the rising tide to rescue many area residents, mostly women, children, and elderly people. At one point, a group of firefighters was trapped while responding to an emergency call. They had to be rescued themselves. One firefighter said the water rose 3 feet in a matter of minutes. Rescue workers found themselves waist deep in the swirling water at times. Mayor George Colella was sharply critical of state officials for not responding quickly to his pleas for amphibious vehicles there. The MDC provided two last night and two today. The Massport Fire Department provided two life rafts. Those rescue efforts are continuing in hopes of evacuating all residents of threatened areas by the next high tide. The major problem facing Boston police tonight is looting. So far, 53 people have been arrested on looting charges. The downtown area is quiet, but there have been several reported incidents of looting in Dorchester, Roxbury, and the South End. Some of the worst incidents were along Washington Street and Norfolk Street in Dorchester. Six people were picked up at a drugstore, four were arrested at a nearby liquor store. One police officer suffered a broken nose when trying to arrest looters. He was treated and released. The situation in the western suburbs seems to be about what you would expect tonight. Impassable roads, some stranded motorists still, police and rescue workers continuing to make sure that medical and emergency personnel get safely to their jobs. This nurse got a ride in an Arlington cruiser up to the Arlington town line, where a police car picked her up for the trip to the nursing home where she works. As you move closer into the city, more people could be found on the streets. The cross-country skier is apparently the most successful in getting where they wanted to go. And almost all of us could take a cue from these firemen and dig out any fire hydrants that may be nearby your home. Elsewhere, the combination bar, restaurant, and museum on the Peter Stuyvesant on Boston's harborside was lifted completely off its concrete pilings today and sank. Fortunately, however, no one was aboard the vessel at the time. And those same high seas are expected to cause more problems for people living along the coast. If you live in a shorefront home and were evacuated earlier, officials are advising that you not go home until after the high tide begins to end after midnight. Specifically, we are told that two-thirds of the people in Hull are experiencing flooding at this time, and 200 of them are waiting to be evacuated. In Plymouth, heavy damage is reported along Whitehorse Beach and Long Beach sections of town. An apartment complex in Nahant has been severely damaged, and one person is believed drowned there. Efforts are continuing to get people off the island. As a general rule, more flooding is expected along coastal areas tonight, but it should not be as bad as last night and this morning. A traveler's advisory is also posted in New Hampshire and Maine. Tides in both those states will run above normal, with some coastal flooding and beach erosion there as well. Governor Meldrum Thompson is trying to have New Hampshire declared a disaster area. He has already declared a state of emergency there and called in the National Guard. High winds and strong, high tides and strong winds have also taken their toll on Cape Cod. The outermost house, a national literary landmark located in East Hampton, has been washed away. The outermost house was made famous in the early 20th century by the writer Henry Beston, who wrote a book about his stay there. The house was one of five on Coast Guard Beach to be washed away. Two Winchester boys died today after they apparently crawled into a car to keep warm. Police said the youngsters were shoveling snow in a driveway. They climbed into the car to rest and were overcome by carbon monoxide. 12-year-old John Ganji and 11-year-old Matthew Lawton were pronounced dead at the hospital. A three-alarm fire is still burning at this hour in Lawrence. All three alarms were pulled in less than 10 minutes at a furniture store and studio shop on Manchester Street. Additional units from Haverhill and Lowell are covering the rest of the city there, while Lawrence and Methuen firemen battle that fire. The MBTA says service tomorrow will be very slow. That's one more good reason to stay home. Here's the service that will be operating, all underground, of course. The Green Line will be running from Leechmere to Kenmore Square. The Red Line from Harvard to Andrew Square. The Orange Line will be running from Forest Hills to South Station, and the Blue Line from Bowdoin to the airport. There will be no bus service and no commuter rail service at all tomorrow. That in compliance with the governor's request to keep vehicles off the street. However, the T does want snow shovelers tomorrow. Hiring starts at 6:30 in Dudley Station on the Orange Line with a 7 a.m. report time at Cabot Center. Shovels are provided in those locations. At South Station, hiring begins at 9, but you must bring your own shovel there. The pay is $3 an hour, and you must be at least 16 years old. Massachusetts Electric Utilities tonight report that most major outages are restored at this hour. Boston Edison says power to the Back Bay came on around 7 o'clock this evening. There are still sections of East and South Boston, however, that do not have electricity. Crews are on the way to those locations, and scattered outages are also reported in other parts of the Boston Edison system. Most customers of Mass Electric do have power at this hour. That utility reports that there are scattered outages on the north and south shores, but no major areas without power. Jack?
There are several telephone numbers you should have available during this storm emergency, so get a pencil and paper. You may want to take them down. Here they are. A special snow center has been set up in Boston. The number is 725-3050. Problems with bursting water pipes will be handled at 268-3955. The latest MBTA information is available by calling 722-5050. And for police, fire, and ambulance service in many communities, call 911 or check the inside cover of your telephone directory. Boston Edison customers with electrical problems should call 262-4700. Massachusetts Electric customers should get their number from the local phone directory, or it's also on Mass Electric bills. Special snow center has been set up in cities surrounding Boston. The number in Newton, 552-7200. There are three numbers in Brookline, 277-8149, 734-0113, and 734-0116. An emergency shelter has been set up for Somerville residents at the Armory. The number is 625-0125. The special snow center number in Cambridge is 547-5355. In Quincy, all emergency services are being handled by City Hall. The number is 773-1380. Newton has a couple of shelters. You can get information about transportation to the centers at 552-7119. If we didn't list your city or town, check your phone book for emergency numbers. Also, please don't call the emergency numbers unless you have an emergency. Unnecessary calls just jam up the phone system. Also, try to find numbers in the phone book instead of calling for operator assistance. That also clears the lines for bona fide emergencies. We here in New England have no corner on the storm market. There have been blizzards today from Boston to Billings, Montana. But the eastern seaboard took the most severe weather blows. Rhode Island, perhaps, was dealt the most severe weather. Thousands of cars remain stranded in the snowdrifts. 12 people have lost their lives in Rhode Island as a direct result of the storm. Army troops are on their way to help. In Connecticut, highways remain closed. Hundreds of cars are deserted. In New York City, the airports remain closed, but the worst is over, and the cleanup is well underway. There, at least 5 deaths are blamed on the bad weather. All up and down the eastern seaboard, the reports of heavy damage continue to come in. It may be some time until the full financial impact of this record-breaking storm will be known. But Bruce says the worst is over, but as long as that wind continues to blow, something tells me the cleanup is going to be tough. Bruce will have more information in just a moment.
Oh, Mr. Potts, what great homemade soup.
It's new soup starter.
Soup starter.
Everything for homemade soup, except the meat.
This homemade soup was made with rich stock.
It comes with soup starter. You start with fresh meat, then simmer with soup starter's vegetables, stock, and seasonings for 90 minutes. And homemade soup.
It's so easy. I'll feel guilty. But I'll get over it.
New soup starter. Everything for homemade soup, except the meat.
General Electric's great annual red tag sale is now on. GE has reduced its prices to dealers in varying amounts on selected major appliances. For example, this washer and matching dryer. Range with self-cleaning oven. Side-by-side refrigerator freezer. So now you may get big savings by seeing your participating GE dealer for his red tag prices. But hurry, the GE great annual red tag sale ends March 5th. See this participating GE dealer.
Hey, hon, is this Sunday?
Come on, you know it's Tuesday.
But with sausages?
Mm-hmm.
Jones Minute Breakfast Links. They're ready in minutes.
Jones Minute Breakfast Links let you enjoy real Sunday morning taste any day of the week. They're made with choice cuts of meat, and unlike other quick browning sausages, they've got that delicious Jones taste.
Mmm, maybe Tuesday, but it sure tastes like Sunday.
Jones Minute Breakfast Links. Real Sunday morning taste any day of the week.
I've probably been to 437 potluck dinners. Same old salad, same old casseroles. Then I thought of LaCroix Oriental vegetables. LaCroix bean sprouts crisp up a salad. LaCroix chopped sweet vegetables in my casserole. And LaCroix water chestnuts turn plain green beans into something special. Just think of it.
LaCroix makes Chinese food. Swing American.
Think of it.
This is a warning. At Boston Memorial Hospital, your body is worth more than your life.
It's a 31-year-old male. The beating now stands at 42.5.
And about a dozen of these coma cases here in the last year. Hard to imagine it's murder.
Are you sure?
Now, the number one best-selling mystery becomes the most thrilling suspense film of the year. Coma, rated PG.
Starts Wednesday at the Sanctuary Boston in cinemas Framingham, Woburn, Dedham, and Liberty Tree Mall, Danvers.
For 2 days now, you've heard us talk an awful lot about this storm. There is a possibility of another storm on the horizon. I find that hard to believe.
Saturday morning, but right now, I wouldn't be too optimistic or pessimistic, depending upon your point of view. Oh, well, some people love this. And depending upon your point of view, I think it's going to stay far enough south that we're not going to have to worry about it. But there is a potential there, so beware. Let's talk about current conditions. Everything on the way to the good side. We take a look at our national weather map, and we have the cold air, the drier air coming in from the west, the Midwest, and here's the giant circulation around the low, which is now about 150 miles due east of the Cape, and the circulation swing down with the northerly winds, cold air across the Great Lakes causing heavy snow, Chicago, Cleveland, and points east as we got the cold air over the waters once again, half a foot of snow at many of those locations. Cold air penetrating to the south, even in Florida, only in the 40s today, so don't take too much gas from your friends who are calling you up from down there to give you a little juice about what's going on up here. Also, miserable weather for the Mardi Gras. Rain in the 40s, 3 to 6 inches of snow in northern Louisiana, and some 30s in, even near New Orleans. This low is a tropical low, at least it looks like one, with lots of heavy rain falling down there. Of course, moisture feeding up here is causing heavy snow through much of Montana, Wyoming. Farther to the west, it's rainy through all of the northwest and southward to Los Angeles and even down into Tijuana. So we are not the only ones experiencing the miserable weather. But what was I worried about last night? I was worried about that beastly low down there along the south coast of New England. It was coming our way. In fact, it looked like it was going to head right on into the Boston area. But then as it moved into the Connecticut coastal area, it started making a turn. And that was a major problem, because as it started coming back to the east here, that meant we kept a northeasterly flow instead of bringing the winds around to the southeast. And of course, that northeasterly flow coming across the ocean waters then promoted the moisture transport across the ocean in here in the Boston area, and bango, we had all kinds of problems. Also, the air started circulating around and hooking around in here, bringing in some drier air, some sunny air, and look at what it did. On the satellite picture, that clear shot came right into Cape Cod and the islands. And we'll take a closer look now at that satellite picture. And in fact, if you look right about in here, you can see what appears to be an eye of the storm with the clear air circulating in just toward Cape Cod and the islands. So we pick up the low. This was during the early morning hours, and it continued to drift slowly to the east, all the while pumping in that northeasterly flow. In it came, more and more precipitation came in. Then it sort of started to die down. We started saying, hey, it's all going to be over, right? But then, bands, what appeared to be spiral bands, came down across and around, much like a pinwheel, and down they came with occasional periods of heavy snow. So we weren't out of the woods. But now it's far enough offshore that we don't have to worry about it. So, we go back and we talk about the good news. We talk about the clouds moving to the east, the high-pressure area moving in, and we kiss it all goodbye. In fact, we're seeing the clearing skies coming up in southwestern New England right now. 20s, 28 New York City, northwesterly winds. We trace a clear line down through Albany, just to the south of Providence. The snow is ending at Nantucket. In fact, the only areas reporting continual snow are right along the immediate coastline, right on up on into Maine. Otherwise, just snow showers out here. Temperatures are in the 20s. This is going to be working in like this as the low goes that way. So here's our forecast for Boston and vicinity coming up for tonight. Look for snow showers, temperatures in the lower 20s by morning. The northerly wind, in fact, will start breaking out by early morning. And look at this. Citified Dr. Zhivago out there, Boston, very quiet and beautiful. Tomorrow, partly sunny skies, Courier and Ives. Tomorrow, in the upper 20s, northwesterly winds will be cold and gusty, drifting snow. For tomorrow night, clear skies, cold with a northwesterly wind. And as life comes back to the city, Thursday, sunny, a little warmer, with a light westerly wind. So the winds will be a problem tonight and tomorrow, and then they'll diminish and we'll be all set.
You're probably right. Moscow, they're probably saying, eh, niet.
No big deal, right?
May I say both to you and to Don Kent, great job.
May I say to you, great job. We've all been sleepless for many days, it seems.
Wish you'd get home and change your clothes.
Stay away. That's far away.
Oh, well, with all of the snow, you probably are wondering, can there be sports? Of course there can be sports.
Can there be life after death? The Celtics are proving it. They did it again in Indianapolis tonight.
All right, Celtics, good news. Okay, Lynn, we'll have sports right after this.
Some candid, unrehearsed, but very welcome comments from owners of Buick's new Regal.
Love it. I could not possibly be happier than I am with my new Regal.
And I think that it would sell itself. The styling is there, the economy's there.
Super.
Fantastic. Fantastic car.
It handles like a dream. It's the kind of car that I would want you to drive.
Buick's new Regal. It's drawing a crowd at your Buick dealer.
No time for breakfast. I've got to meet... Say, those donuts look nice and fresh.
My alarm never went off. I'll grab something. Those crumb cakes smell heavenly.
Funny how people with no time for breakfast often find time when breakfast means Hostess crumb cakes, fresh from the Hostess Breakfast Bake Shop in your store.
Crumb cake, please.
Sure it won't make you late?
Keep them home for breakfast with Hostess Donuts and Crumb Cakes.
Sunglasses, stylish, sexy, and too dark to wear indoors. Unless they have sun sensor lenses. Indoors, they lighten, so you can see clearly. But outdoors, they get dark again automatically and cut glare. So buy sunglasses with sun sensor lenses. If you want to look like one of the beautiful people, you have to see what you're doing. Look for the tag that says sun sensor, lenses that change.
A Celtics win, eh?
Oh, on the way. Forget the snow, Gail. There's a really big story tonight out there. The Celtics have won four straight, their best of the year. And they won a real-life road game in somewhere other than Milwaukee. It actually happened in Indianapolis tonight, and Johnny Most was there.
The Boston Celtics hung on to win a very big ball game on the road in Indiana, 92-89. They watched a 16-point lead melt away in the fourth quarter, but they got the big plays from Dave Cowens and John Havlicek. Cowens with a rebound right at the end, got fouled, and gave them the three-point lead that stuck. The final score again, 92-89. This is Johnny Most, back to Len.
Thank you, Johnny. Celtics win by three. Cowens with 18 points led the way. Tomorrow night, we will televise from Kansas City. Bob Cousy is there. Elsewhere, Los Angeles trounced Buffalo. Cleveland did the same to New Orleans. Philadelphia leading Chicago. Game delayed there. It's only in the third quarter. Philadelphia had a lot of trouble getting to Chicago. The Nets never got to San Antonio, and neither did Portland get to New York City. National Hockey League, the Islanders snowed out their game on Long Island. Pittsburgh leading Colorado. The Bruins will scramble out of Manchester, New Hampshire tomorrow morning to try to get to Detroit for Thursday's game out there. Forget collegiate basketball. UMass at Rutgers, Fairfield at Army, Brown at Yale, Rhode Island at St. John's, all wiped out. And tomorrow's big game at Notre Dame with Holy Cross, that's been postponed as well. And so one blizzard, two power dips, and 12,000 hardy fans later, it's the same old beanpot. Harvard and BU next Monday, just as it's been nine of the past 12 years. Harvard showed you something last night, riddled with injuries all season, pasted by Northeastern last month. They showed resiliency in beating Northeastern in overtime to get into the finals with their 4-3 victory.
You know, obviously, I think everyone would like a shot at BU because they're number one, and we'd like to be the first one to knock them over. But
perhaps an impossible task for Billy Cleary and Harvard, not only playing a 20-0 BU machine, but a BU machine that's seeking revenge.
We're going to battle them. They battled us pretty good last year and beat us 4-3, and we were the favorite. We'll probably be the favorite going in again, and we'll know we'll have one heck of a task on our hands to get by the Crimson of Harvard.
One other note, BC's fine goalie Paul Skidmore will not play in Monday's consolation game prior to the finals. He suffered a severe reoccurrence of a groin injury. He checked in and out of the hospital last night. Paul Skidmore is sidelined indefinitely. 100 fans and employees spent last night at Boston Garden. Best line from Bruins general manager Harry Sinden. He spent the night in the Bruins locker room. Outside the door, kids played a game of hockey with brooms and paper cups. They played all night. One team was Buffalo, the other Boston. Sinden couldn't sleep. What's worse, he said, Buffalo won the game. That's sports.
And that's ironic. Okay, Jack?
Before we wrap up this newscast tonight, Gail, let's go back for one more update from the MDC Communications Center and Eyewitness News reporter Jerry Liddell. Jerry?
Thank you, Jack. This update has some encouraging news tonight. Those troops from Fort Devens that were stalled on 128 are moving again. They are moving along the Mass Pike very slowly. They'll be taking Route 1, 1A into Revere to try to help out the people there. Tomorrow, when those troops in Fort Bragg arrive, the first thing they'll be doing is clearing up the problems on 128, the very same problems that caused the Fort Devens troops so much trouble. As for driving tomorrow, in a very quick word, don't. And in fact, if you're out on the state and the highways, the Commonwealth highways, you are breaking the law in this state of emergency of ours. Jack?
All right, Jerry, thank you very much. Again, some looting is taking place, some flooding is going on in Hall. We have not seen the end of the storm. Crews will begin to start to tackle the problem, but it could be the weekend or the first part of next week until we get back to even the beginnings of normalcy.
And speaking of that, we'll try to keep you updated. Good night.
Instant Eye Hotline. If you see news happening, call 783-4444.
Plowing through the next snowstorm, Thursday at 8 on Action 4.